All right, so hello everyone. Welcome to our first presentation for month three, theme three, which is talking about bad science, quote unquote. And so I want to start off our theme three by talking about from science to myth, the impact of publication incentivization and sensationalization of science in the media. Try saying that five times fast. I cannot. Oh, hello? Okay, but first off, before I kind of get into the nitty-gritty of what I want to talk about, I want to clear up a couple of definitions, especially since we're kind of talking about a kind of arbitrary term of bad science throughout this theme. So first off, when we talk about bad science, what exactly are we referring to here? And so from what I've seen in the literature and most articles that cover this, bad science is more so talking about otherwise like well-meaning science. And I know that's kind of vague, but it's research or findings that otherwise have been following the scientific method in its most basic form. But the thing is, there are some places where it had some error and some biases that affected the results or the findings. And those can either be intentional, so malpractice, or it can either be unintentional, like human error, whatever it may be. And so it's essentially like science that has some merits for improvement. Versus if we're talking about or comparing it to pseudoscience. So pseudoscience more so is concerning any kind of findings or research, quote unquote, that has no basis in the scientific method. So it's not really following any standard methods. And a lot of it is really guilty of confirmation bias. And that's one way to actually kind of detect pseudoscience. And so when we're talking about confirmation bias here, it's those kind of reports or research that it's only looking for evidence that's going to prove or like, I guess, support its hypothesis. And again, when we go back to the basics of like the scientific method and with any kind of biomedical research, a hypothesis is there meant to be proven or disproven. And so with pseudoscience, a lot of times it's the kind of researcher findings that it's going to discredit or just like basically deny anything that says it might be wrong. And so that's, you know, not good science. And then finally, when we're talking about sensationalization, which it's a pretty broad term and it can be applied to a lot of different things, but especially in the sense of media here, we're going to be using the definition of sensationalization as presenting any kind of information or matter in a very extravagant way, or basically exaggerating or pulling the details to make something more captivating or appealing or intriguing to an audience. So especially we're going to be talking about how the media can kind of do this with some kind of research in science. So understanding these specific definitions, then I'm, rather than pseudoscience, I'm going to be kind of focusing more on like bad science. So science that was well-meaning or well-intentioned, but kind of went wrong somewhere along the way. So there's a lot of different, again, going back to our basic kind of formula or setup of the scientific method here, there's a lot of different places where science can go wrong. So in the initial kind of hypothesis formation or the background research or lit review and observations that we're making, if say you are using background or literature view onto studies that already have error within themselves, or like maybe there was falsified findings, et cetera, you can kind of already be setting like on the wrong foot or like setting yourself up for error by going on with that kind of research or that kind of background information. And then when you are down to your own methods, when you are like conducting an experiment or some kind of protocol in the data collection and acquisition methods, if it's not following protocol, i.e. if, you know, not per IRB protocol, or it's not, proper consent wasn't administered or received, et cetera, there can be some error and some malpractice that goes into that. With your results and statistics, I believe there's a lot of things that can go wrong here when you actually have the data and you start to manipulate it or start to try to extract some kind of significant findings out of it. I believe one of the terms that you see most often is p-hacking. Maybe some of my stats friends can talk about that later, but I kind of manipulating the data or like improperly using the data in a way that makes it seem more significant or more significant than it really is. And then that kind of goes along the same lines of analysis and then interpretation of the data. So if you're kind of wrongfully using the wrong data, or it's showing something that you don't like, and then you're, you know, adjusting it to make it seem prettier and nicer to fit your and fulfill your hypothesis, then that's obviously malpractice and kind of human error going into that. And then finally, at kind of like the last steps of it, you have the peer review and then publication process. And a lot of times, if even the peer review is instilled and it's meant to prevent this kind of error from happening, a lot of times if there are unethical practices or processes in the peer review process and then publication methods, a lot of times these errors can result in falsified information or data being published. And so kind of focusing more on when the media comes into play, it's more along this kind of like last steps of like when something is published and something has like, you know, misfactual information. And so I want to like start off the presentation or going into the details of it with this first article, which I included in the folder, but by Smaldino and Mikhail Wraith from 2016. And so it's titled The Natural Selection of Bad Science. And I thought it was pretty interesting because when reading the literature about, you know, trying to figure out bad science or like how data is misrepresented, et cetera, this article showed a pretty interesting empirical analysis of it, and more so than I saw from some other articles in the literature that I found. And so essentially, it was writing off of this idea that incentive is what drives cultural evolution. And in this case, it looked at bad science in ecological or evolutionary framework. And so it built off of this idea of Campbell's law, which I didn't really look into who this Campbell is or how that nomenclature came about. But essentially, it was going off of the idea that the increasing incentive for publication, so the positive kind of reinforcement or incentivization of getting papers out there and getting your name on something or authoring or publishing something, is what's allowing poor research design and analysis to get away. And that's on the idea that researchers and then PIs or whoever are the ones that, you know, in these labs that are pulling out these publications, they're just strategizing and they're kind of like morphing their scientific method or them going about their research to ensure publication rather than actually going back to like, okay, like, is the science being conducted properly or is the experiment protocol being executed appropriately. And another kind of framework that they mentioned in the paper is that this idea, and again, this is kind of like playing into their having this analogy of like an evolutionary or ecological like viewpoint with natural selection and looking at research in that way. More successful labs, so success kind of like fitness being described as the number or quantity of publications that you have and authorship that you have, more successful labs are going to produce more progeny. And here progeny are like the personnel, so the postdocs, the grad students, the researchers that are coming out of these labs. You assume that the more progeny and more like publications that this lab produces, you then have these people who are, you know, advancing more and more in their careers that are later going on to create their own labs or start more of their own projects and result in more of their own publications. And so with the increase of these kind of progeny that come out of these successful labs, they're most likely to copy and use the methods in those labs of their own. So with this kind of culture and this like evolution of the academic and research culture around like, hey, just get the publications out there and like that positive incentivization, it's going to result in more of this poor research design and the poor analysis getting in the way and at the expense of that. And so I thought it was a very interesting analogy, and they went into more detail, which I'll get to in the next couple of slides. But the paper and these authors also brought up the idea that replication, which is something that, you know, is considered in the scientific method of being able to replicate data results to like improve validity of it. It was bringing up again that idea that scientific research and something that the current like academics fear of it has kind of gone away from is that scientific research shouldn't solely be focused on novel results. That we should go back and we should remember the key, like the importance of being able to replicate results and the merit that goes into publishing those kind of results. They continued on to say though that unfortunately, like, replication itself and focusing on that isn't enough to just curb like this whole quote unquote natural selection of bad science, because the thing is, the way it naturally is in the current sphere of like research and academia, studies about replication or studies that don't show positive results just don't get published as much. So in order to show this, and again, going on to the empirical evidence that this paper tried to show, they actually used a mathematical model of this evolution and using this evolutionary ecological viewpoint or perspective. And they did a simulation, they ran a simulation with this mathematical model to see basically like the success or the probability of these novel hypotheses from, say, a variety of labs being true. And so I will say this is where it gets into a bit more of like the mathematics and the statistics of it, which I personally just don't have enough understanding or a grasp on. I tried to pinpoint which conclusions were probably the most valuable in terms of like including in this talk. And so this is one of the equations that they mentioned where they were looking at trying to measure or see the mathematical relationship between a false positive rate and considering certain factors. And a couple of the more important factors that they talked about was the power or the lab's power. And power, it was form a metric of talking about the statistical power, which if I remember correctly, it's statistical power is referring to the stats friends might have to correct me on this, but I believe it's the likelihood of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is indeed false. So it's kind of like when you're correct, essentially. So higher power is considered, I guess, good in a way. That I apologize if I'm misrepresenting or misquoting that, but that is my understanding from when I was reading this. But that was one of the factors they considered. And then effort by this variable E was also considered in some of their equations, where effort in general was talking about the summation of the rigor that the lab was putting into carrying out the scientific method. So how, like, the technologies, the cost, the time, essentially overall the effort that the lab was putting into getting their results and carrying out their methods. Base rate B, which I believe was referring to just a base rate of positive results that comes out of a lab. Again, these are kind of arbitrary, makes more sense possibly in the original paper itself, if anyone does want to take a look at that. But essentially, from their data, the only two graphs I'll pull out is this first one, where they were able to show from the simulation and these mathematical models that there was indeed a relationship, and that power of the lab increases and goes up to one, which was assumed to be the max, false positive rate represented by alpha, and then the false discovery rate represented by these two lines here, those also steadily increased over time, and they eventually reached a point of like 100% false positive rate as well. And then in the second graph here, it also shows, so effort was apparently, the paper said that effort was technically a variable independent of power here. So in a different portion of the simulation, they showed that effort actually evolves. And so that as effort decreased, or the simulated labs put in less effort towards ensuring their scientific methods were being carried out, the power increased as well. And so it was basically these mathematical models and the graphs that they were able to show. The concluding statement of it was that there is this like very logical and mathematical relationship that exists between the amount of effort that the lab puts out and their possibility or rate of getting a false positive, or these like incorrect assumptions from their data and from their methods. So knowing what came out of the math there, essentially it's trying to show that with these relationships that do exist, and this increased like evolution of culture surrounding the positive selection for incentivization for publication, and which can lead to bad practice from these labs and from these research studies. Essentially, what some of the downstream effects that we're seeing of this is in these publications, in these studies, we're seeing increased use of very pointed terminology. And so things like this is groundbreaking or novel, newfound discovery or newfound research, et cetera. And in addition to that, we're seeing a lack of negative results that are published because of the incentivization and the reward that goes with only publishing about positive results, no matter what it is. And with that, we're also seeing a lack of any replication studies that really go towards being published and being rewarded for being published. In addition, with this and the culture that surrounds this and is created out of this, it also creates opportunities for media outlets to consume these discoveries and these newfound novel things that are being researched, and then it leads to misguided reports. And so this then can lead to deceiving information and very damaging outcomes from these media reports. And so this kind of goes into like the problem that we want to address with media sensationalization of the research that is coming out. And so the reason the problem can be even exacerbated even more, and this is drawing on some of the literature that I saw, but also significantly this op-ed from the Washington Post, is that there is a disconnect between journalists in the media, even science journalists, and then understanding flawed research design from the research component or the research perspective. Not necessarily opposite ends of the spectrum, but kind of two sides of the same coin here when it comes to research, when it comes to reporting about research. And so then other factors that are exacerbating the problem is that you see touting, or kind of the need to sell, or the need to really get out the results of the researchers, whether they are necessarily accurate or fully well-researched or not. In addition, a lot of the media outlets and reports of it will use very vague terminology and language, or they will leave out very critical details or limitations that may have been included in the study itself, but are maybe left out of the BuzzFeed article or the new CNN article, whatever it may be. And the other side of the problem is that people will, laymen, people who aren't necessarily in academia or in research, they might believe some of these falsified reports or believe some of these things that are being touted or being very stretched out and exaggerated. And so it The op-ed kind of brought up the idea, again, kind of the two sides of the same coin here, is that there's a media incentive, and with journalism, with media, you are making and selling headlines. You know, you're supposed to inform readers. While scientific research, the incentive, it's not necessarily to get published, hence the question mark, but nowadays, because again, what the other study was addressing, the culture around scientific research incentive, and unfortunately a lot of the motivation is to get published, hence why we run into the issue at hand. And again, one thing I wanna like touch on is the distrust and misbelief from citizens that can come in science as a result of this one sensationalization of the media, but of media reporting science, but also just research being portrayed the way it is due to the incentivization of rapid publication. And so using the term lay public from this article from the Journal of Ethics as well, though it is from 2007, which was pretty long ago, it still definitely holds true in that for the general public, their understanding of science or these research or results, maybe it comes from their doctors, but it mostly comes from media and news outlets. You know, if you give them a NIH article versus a, you know, quick CNN reel, like there's one or the other that's they're going to take the time to consume, but also understand better. And so as a result of this kind of dependence on the lay public's understanding of science from media news outlets and what they consume, they're in the sensationalization of media as a result of the issues we mentioned earlier. It, again, sounds repetitive, but it's leading to this problem of inaccurate reports. Citizens can have false hope and beliefs. It can distort the findings that are genuinely from the research, but maybe not well understood due to the misrepresentation. And again, it leads to the lack of belief or trust in true scientific discoveries when they do learn about these misconceptions that can come out of the research. And so kind of focusing on like a case study, but not really a case study here. Obviously my background in nutrition, I know about this a bit more from the side of nutrition sciences and the way it is perceived as a result of one, the research side of it, but two, how it's portrayed in the media. And nutrition gets a lot of the heat of it. So this is one excerpt from an article, a pretty recent article by Archer, which was actually published in Frontiers and in Nutrition. And so it was considered very like, whoa, groundbreaking, like very controversial, because essentially it was this researcher who was calling out nutrition sciences for its lack of concrete data, its how contradictory it can be. And honestly, in nutrition sciences, that's a lot of the very, very common complaints against it. It's that it's very inconsistent in the findings. One day you'll see that, oh, cholesterol, like this form of cholesterol from this food is good for you, versus the next day, or even an opposite study or different study, you'll see that completely opposite evidence that they found that is not good for you. So it's like, what is the truth here? There's also complaints, and from this article, they kind of like touched on it, that there's in nutrition studies, given the extent of what needs to be studied, whether it's someone's diet, habits, or down to the biomolecular contents of what someone is eating, there's a lot of room for human error and biases and weak methodology given what is meant to be studied. And on the flip side of it, versus just like criticizing the nutrition sciences, there is also the issue where researchers in the field of dietetics and nutrition sciences, just there is the issue that because of the FDA and existence of government regulation, it is very hard to be able to conduct these sciences in well-measured terms. It's difficult to come to exact conclusions. And then there's a lot of confounding factors that come out of dietetics and nutrition sciences. And I don't have like specific, there are a lot that would have to honestly be its own presentation about like, you know, the contraindications or contradictions that come out of nutrition sciences. But a lot of it has to do with the fact that it's there's poor regulation on both government and private labs, and a lot of restrictive hold on it that prevents kind of the most accurate or the best science and research to come out of it. Kind of just talking about nutrition as like in a general sense is like one example of this. Obviously this issue does kind of present itself and manifest itself in a wide variety of biomedical sciences and any field of science, honestly. And so the question then becomes, what can we do about it? And obviously, again, kind of like similar to my last presentation, there's no real like concrete end all be all answer to this, but we do have some evidence and there are some ideas, namely, at the individual and institutional levels, we need to improve the quality of research, and the scientific methodology needs to improve in what we're doing. And I may be biased saying that coming from a research perspective, but at the end of the day, we are the ones conducting this research. We are the ones putting this information out there for the public, for the layman. And if those qualities of the research methods do not improve, we can't expect the portrayal of research or the portrayal of the evidence and findings that we have to improve. And so with that, there are also, again, as I touched on, some other factors. For one, referring to the previous study I talked about, changing the culture around the push for publication, you know, instead of just incentivizing that, there needs to be, again, institutional and individual level changes for rewarding, instead of just tons of publications and tons of authorship, rewarding extra caution that's taken during procedures, making sure methodology and protocol is actually followed, you know, rather than just positive results. In addition, there should be probably a more push for emphasis on ethical peer review policies, because if some journal publications are not following these ethical policies or ensuring that peer review is actually unbiased or it's actually being conducted properly, then we can expect change to happen there in the publication process. In addition, and just from my own research, kind of like looking into this, I think there needs to be a lot more empirical research about the research that is translated into the media. That seems like kind of like an oxymoron or like a meta-analysis kind of, but that needs to be done. We need to see and understand a little bit more about how, what are the steps being taken, maybe from the journalism or media side of it, of how this is being translated and what other factors go into how we can improve it. And in general, again, this is kind of a vague term, but we need to limit the sensationalization of research. And this goes from how it's being published to also how it is being portrayed in the media. And last but not least, which I personally think could be the most important, is at the individual level and, you know, to peers, to us as budding scientists especially, we need to check ourselves and we should check our colleagues and the people that we are working in our labs with or we are working in our classes, et cetera, with. Because, yeah, you know, as a young postdoc or a young doctoral student or whoever, you might not, you know, want to go against or talk against your PI or your postdoc's methods, anything like that. Not that you necessarily need to, but at the end of the day, we are the ones who are going to be the future postdocs, clinical scientists, doctors, et cetera. And if we kind of carry and instill these proper practices in ourselves now and understand it from an earlier side, we can be the next ones ensuring that, you know, these proper practices and proper portrayal of research is ethically being conducted and actually being pushed for in the future. And so, yeah, that ends my presentation today. And that is all I want to talk to you all about today about research in the media. Thank you.